and welcome to the iPhone Life podcast. I'm Donna Schill, editor-in-chief at iPhone Life.
And I'm David Auerbach, CEO and publisher.
Each episode, we bring to you the best apps, top tips, and great gear in the iOS world. We have some more iOS 16 public beta experiences to share with you in this episode, and also, of course, apps and gear and tips throughout the next hour, so stay tuned. First, David's going to have some messages from our sponsors.
Yeah, so we have two great sponsors today. The first one I'm going to tell you about is Jamf. And Jamf is an enterprise software that allows you to manage your Apple devices. So if you are a company that gives your employees iPhones, iPads, Macs, any Apple devices, there's a lot of extra work that you have to do to get them set up and ready to go. You have to, if you have custom apps, you have to upload those. If you have extra security settings, you have to set that up. And even just basic password management, things like that. So Jamf makes it easy to do all of that. And what they do is they help you connect, so you can connect your device, you can manage it. And the third thing that they do, which is they've added a lot to recently, is protect. So now all Apple devices using Jamf have an extra layer of protection for malware and things like that. So it's not only for large companies, although large companies do use it. 7 out of the 10 top tech companies use it, 15 out of the top 15 US banks use it, but it can be small for small businesses as well, and you can have a free trial. So go to jamf.com to learn more, J-A-M-F. And our second sponsor is Withings. And Withings has a really great line of smart, connected health products. And we've told you a lot about their ScanWatch, which is a smartwatch that actually looks like a traditional watch. It's one of my favorite smartwatches. And we've told you about their Blood Pressure Connect, their BPM Connect, and it's a smart blood pressure cuff. Today, though, I wanted to tell you guys, tell you about their sleeping pad, because I've been using it for, oh gosh, a few months now, and I'm really enjoying it. It's a pad that slips under your mattress, and it tracks your sleep, and in the morning you wake up and it gives you a score. It tells you how long you slept, the quality of your sleep, whether you're awake. It even tells you if you snored. And so I've been I've been really enjoying it as a way of just monitoring the quality of my sleep, because it's not just how long you slept, it's how well you slept, and you can learn a lot of useful things. Do you do any sleep tracking?
I don't. I wish that there was a sleep tracking that would stop me from grinding my teeth at night. I wonder if I can track that too.
I don't know. But what I like about this one is a lot of the sleep trackers are like things you literally wear. Like your Apple Watch can do sleep tracking, but who wants to wear their Apple Watch at night?
Yeah,
so this just slides under bed. It's completely non-obtrusive. If you sleep with a partner, you can put it on your side of the bed and it's supposed to only track yours. So I've been really enjoying it.
Yeah, it's part of the reason I haven't done it before is because I haven't wanted to wear my Apple Watch to bed, so
exactly.
It's nice to know there are other options.
Exactly.
All right, next up, I want to tell you about our free daily tip newsletter. If you sign up, we send you one cool thing you can do with your iPhone that you can learn in 1 minute a day, and you can go sign up at iphonelife.com/dailytips. So I have sort of an email theme for the day where I have a tip and an ask an expert question that both were about email on your iPhone. We get a lot of questions about email.
Yeah.
It can be a source of frustration and confusion. So we love giving you some handy tips and tricks to help make it more effective on your iPhone. So this was a tip, how to delete all emails from one sender on your iPhone. And there's some kind of a couple other tips that end up coming out that I liked in this tip, including how to select a bunch of emails and delete them all at once, which I think people have some issues
doing. We get that question a lot, actually.
Yeah, I mean, it's one that I want to know how to do. A lot of times I get so many emails and I want just a quick way to delete a bunch of them. So here's what you do. If you have an email from one sender, you're just wanting to clear that out of your inbox, you can quickly search for that sender and then go in and delete them. So open the Mail app, go to your inboxes. What I like to do is tap all inboxes so that if from this one sender you want to delete messages, maybe they've emailed you at two separate addresses. So you'll get all emails sent to you that you have registered with your iPhone or accounts you've set up on your iPhone all at once. So go to all inboxes, then tap the search field and enter the name of the sender you want to delete. Be sure to double check the emails your search has pulled up. So, because depending on the keywords you entered, you may receive emails from other senders too. So you want to first make sure you're really only seeing emails from that specific sender. Then what you do is you tap and hold with two fingers and drag down to select all the emails that you see from that sender. And this is a shortcut for selecting a bunch of, and this is a shortcut that David discovered, right?
I see it has made its way into the daily tips, I'm proud to say. But yeah, it's a cool little bonus tip if you guys didn't miss the episode where we talked about it. I discovered one day that if you tap and hold with two fingers, you can select and just drag down. And this works not only for this tip, but it works in the mail app, but it works in text messages. It works in reminders. And there's a few other apps that it'll work for.
Yeah. So that's a hidden, like a really handy hidden tip.
Yeah.
So once you've selected all the emails, you hit the trash can icon and they're deleted. So that's just, you know, a tip that gives you a few things to help you navigate the mail app and then also clear out emails because nobody likes an overstuffed email inbox. So again, if you want to be on our daily tips list, go to iphonelife.com/daily tips. And to continue on with our tip theme, I have a question from one of our insiders that's also about email. So to back up, I wanted to tell you about our premium subscription. It's called iPhone Life Insider. And this is really the educational service that helps you master your Apple devices, not just get a little tip and trick here and there, but instead a more comprehensive view of your Apple devices and direct contact with our team where we will support you and help make sure that you're getting the best experience. So when you sign up for Insider, you get in-depth guides, including a downloadable PDF that you can have for reference at any time, and then also step-by-step video tutorials that we have broken into different topics so you can find just what you're looking to watch and then follow along on your Apple device as you watch us on screen explaining it to you. We also really emphasize in all of our guides getting into how we use it in our daily lives to give you ideas and also point out any sort of tricky parts or areas that confused us. So we really go the extra mile and give you more information than you'll find anywhere else on any of our topics. You can get guides on anything from your iPad to the new iOS. Of course, when iOS 16 comes out in September, we're going to have a guide right away for you that teaches you all the cool new features. We also have live courses. We'll have an iOS 16 course coming out in September. We have, and that you can join live sessions and chat with your instructors and fellow insiders. You get Ask an Expert. So whenever you have a tricky tech problem, you have direct access to us and we will answer all of your questions and help you find solutions. So you get that plus a lot more when you go to iphonelife.com/podcast discount, and then you get 30% off just for being a podcast listener. So that's an amazing discount. Plus, if you're a senior, veteran, service personnel, or teacher, you get an extra 10% off for a total of 40% off. So make sure to go cash in on that before iOS 16 comes out. iphonelife.com/podcast discount.
And in addition, because it's relevant to y'all, you get a special version of the podcast that does not have any of these ads. Mm-hmm. And we have bonus content every single episode just for insiders.
Yes. Awesome. So I am going to share with you an insider question now. You'll get an idea of what Ask an Expert is like too. So Bambi wrote in. Hi, first time to submit a question with you. I have 3 email accounts that are on all my Apple devices. Also, welcome, Bambi. Excited that you're using our service. So this insider has a Mac, iPad, iPhone. One of the accounts is a business account that I need to keep but don't need to monitor any longer. My question is there a setting I can turn off for just that one email account so that I don't get notifications and mail icon badges when there's an incoming or unopened email? I'm always thinking I have new emails when they're in the business account and the other two that I, instead of the other two that I monitor. Thanks so much. So just to translate, this person wants to get all the notifications for the 2 email addresses that they currently use, but the business account would like to not get those notifications. So you can do this. You just go into settings, notifications, tap the mail icon, And then at the very bottom, there's an option that says customize notifications. And when you go in there, you'll have the option to toggle on notifications on or off for each of the accounts that you have set up in the Mail app. You'll also, a little bonus tip, it also see at the bottom the option to turn on or off notifications for your VIP inbox. Mm. And this is something I take advantage of a lot. I actually turn off notifications for all my Mail accounts, but I keep them on for VIP. And so I just have certain senders set up as VIPs, and I'll get notified when they email me. But I get so many emails that even if I had notifications on for just one, I would be getting inundated all day.
Yeah.
So
we have a coworker who may or may not share an office with us who has notifications for all of their emails. And so all day we just hear a little ping on his phone.
Yeah, like every minute.
So I don't recommend that in general, not just because I'm being snarky towards my coworker, but also just productivity experts in general don't recommend having notifications for all your emails because it can be disruptive. Emails tend to be one of those things that can be feel more important than they are and get you to drop working on things that might be more important to respond to an email that can wait. So personally, I like your suggestion of a few people, if you want to be disrupted, then great, but for most people, not.
Yeah, and with the VIP inbox too, that's something you can have it be a dynamic thing. I think it's not, you know, I like will very regularly go add people to my VIPs and delete mm-hmm. people from my VIPs because I'll be like, oh, right now I'm waiting to hear from the bank on this thing. So I'll have them be a VIP for that time and then I'll remove them.
Wow, that is an impressive level of organization. Once somebody makes it on my VIP, I can never talk to them for 3 or 4 years and they will still be a VIP.
Still be on your VIP. That's so funny. Yeah, well, it was fun covering some Mail tips with all of you, but we want to get into iOS 16 again. Last episode, I hadn't installed it on my device yet, and David had. Mm-hmm. So I now have had, I think it's been 3 weeks of hands-on time with it, and you know, you've had more time with it too. So it'll be fun to share some features with all of you. Thank you all for writing in. We got a lot of responses from the last episode, and I'd say it was about split down the middle of people who wrote in saying they are going to try the beta, and people said they're going to wait until September. I think both are very valid choices. Unfortunately, I have been experiencing a lot of bugs.
I think it's worth noting because Donna was yelling at me for the last however long it's been because I was so like flippant about it. I had no bugs. I haven't had any bugs. I still haven't had that many bugs.
Really?
So it's worth noting Donna has had not as smooth of an experience as me. What bugs have you had?
No, mine's been terrible. So I have the iPhone 13. And so I don't know if that has to do with it, that I have like a base model, not a pro model phone.
I don't know.
But so my experience was that I updated to iOS 16 beta, and pretty much right away my battery started dying earlier in the day. Usually the iPhone 13 will last me about a day and a half before I need to charge again. And now that's down to a day. And I just had freeze constantly. And it would be like to the point where I'd be trying to get my camera out to take a picture quickly. I was just in Decorah on a family trip last week and like half the time I couldn't get my camera to open and I'd just be like tapping my screen and like something really cute was happening with my niece and nephew and I'm just like, ah, I can't. So then I would like take someone else's phone and take the picture. Oh, wow. It's like that bad.
Wow. I wonder if it is related to the phone because for me, I have the iPhone 13 Pro Max.
Uh-huh.
And so the Pro means I probably have more RAM and processing power.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's true because I have the same chip, but maybe I have more RAM, which allows me to maybe run the operating system without it freezing as much? Because I haven't had any issues with my camera.
I mean, so the camera is one example. Other things would be searching something on Safari. I'll be like trying to open Safari, like it'll open to the last page I was on, and then I'm tapping the screen to try to enter a new URL, and it's like not responding.
Yeah.
Then I've had to like force restart my phone several times.
Wow.
One thing that's helped has been clearing storage from my phone. I had a ton of podcasts. I think I have the 128 gigabyte option on my phone, and I had 100 gigabytes of storage used. So I was getting kind of close to the limit, but not close.
That's not that close, though.
So I cleared out about 20 gigabytes of podcasts that I didn't need, and it's been a bit better, but it's still not great.
Side note, the podcast app just balloons and takes up all your storage all the time. It's so frustrating, and Apple still hasn't given us good controls to manage it. We've been complaining this for at least three operating systems now.
I know, and it's like I'm such a podcast person that I'm still like I just have to regularly go delete stuff.
Yeah, it's so annoying.
But it almost deters you from even wanting to subscribe to podcasts.
It does. No, it totally does.
Yeah.
And it also, I end up using third parties because I find it a little bit easier.
Yeah.
But I also have the Max, which, because I do actually, now that you mention it, I think that my battery life is a little bit worse.
Really?
But my battery tends to last about 2 days. So if it lasts a day and a half, I just don't think much
of it. Who cares?
Yeah.
Yeah. And for the most part, it's the same for me. Like my phone lasts me through the day, so it's not the worst. But I'm sure for those of you listening who have an older iPhone, it's you're getting into like a bigger gamble with running the beta.
Yeah. Honestly. And hopefully, time will tell, but usually these things get cleaned up for the public release. So if you're listening to this and you're worried about the fall, most of the time these are issues related to the beta. But definitely it's a good warning because maybe I was a little bit too flippant about telling everybody there were no bugs. Other than that, what's your experience been when it does work?
Yeah. So my experience otherwise has been good. Where is my iPhone? That's okay. I don't need it to talk about it. I've had a lot of fun with the lock screen features. You walked everyone through that in the last episode. But if you're just tuning in today and didn't listen to last episode, the lock screen has been significantly redesigned. You can now choose photos to set as your lock screen in a way that, I mean, you could do that before, but this time you can layer it with different fonts for the time. You can add widgets to your home screen, and so it's a lot more customizable, and you can also pair focus modes with a certain lock screen, which is cool. So I've played around a lot with those features. I think last time when you were showing me, I'm like, oh, it looks so easy to customize. It actually is. I feel like there is some finesse to it.
Yeah.
And I'm hoping that they have that worked out in September also. So the thing that I think looks really cool is you can do a depth effect with photos, especially portrait mode photos work well for this. So you could have like a picture of your dog, for instance, and like the ear could come out partially in front of the time you're showing. Mm-hmm. But so I was messing with that though, and like most pictures I was choosing, it wasn't working with at first. And it seems like I've now kind of zeroed in on what works. Portrait modes photos are, I think, recommended. I've gotten it to work with non-portrait mode photos, though.
Yeah,
so it's not like exclusive to portrait mode.
Because I have one that was just like a pretty mountain that I got to work. But I agree that it's another one where I was a little bit casual because I just got one to work. But it does, not all photos work, and it takes a little bit of fussing to get it to work.
Yeah, but it does, when it does, it creates a very like 3D effect on your lock screen, which is cool looking.
It's weirdly satisfying, right?
Yeah, it totally is. It's fun being able to customize fonts and colors. I've had a lot of fun with the lock screen that lets you choose certain people and like rotate between them. So it's like, you know how the widgets from iOS 15 have like a photo shuffle one where it'll like choose for you photos to show to you?
Yes.
So you can now do this, but like anytime you tap your lock screen, it'll switch photos, and you can either have it be like people, places, and thing. I can't remember. It'll like let you plants and like animals. You can choose to have rotate through, or it'll show you a list of like your top people in your photos app that it's identified. So I have a lock screen that's exclusively of people, and then I selected just my niece and nephew. So anytime I tap my screen, it'll be like a different picture of my niece or nephew.
Fun.
And that's really sweet. I like that.
I actually hadn't tested that yet. See, this is why we all need to test it, because that's cool. I want to try that.
Yeah, and that might be part of the battery drain issues. I'm constantly like looking at different pictures of my niece and nephew.
Maybe.
One frustration with that though is it gives me a list of like five people I can choose from.
Oh, really?
It doesn't let me, like, I have a ton of people identified in the photos app, so I'm like, why can't I choose?
Weird. Only your favorites. Apple,
but no, it's not even. I mean, my niece and nephew is really glad that they're on there, but then outside of that, it was like sort of random.
So people you didn't actually like that much were on there?
You're like, what a bummer. You're like, was I on there?
Did I make your favorites list by Apple?
I know. Oh, that makes me think of the MySpace days.
Yeah, I was just going to say that.
So yeah, that I had fun with. I've been testing out a little bit of the messages features with editing and unsending. I don't know. The editing and unsending – they've worked fine for me, but I don't know if I'll actually use them that much.
Oh, really? I've had the opposite experience where I find myself going crazy because I want to use them constantly, but they're pretty useless right now unless I'm texting somebody who has the beta.
Yeah.
Every time I have a typo, I want to go fix it, and I can't.
Well, it's funny. It's a feature that other messaging services have had for a while that I realize I don't use that often because it like tells everyone that you edited it, and there's something about that that I don't like. Like, it feels like a public being like, I messed up. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do know what you mean. But I mean, for as an example, the other day had a message that just really went rogue. Like, like, if you just have one word that you typo, you can text it underneath. But it was like four words in one sentence that had all gone bad for me. And I literally just got a question mark response back.
Yeah.
And then I could just go and, like, instead of being like, this word equals that and that word equals that, I just edited it.
That's true. So nice. Like, I'll constantly do like the asterisk and then like the correct word for what I was saying before, but there's still some interpretation needed of like, which word are you fixing? And if there's more. So yeah, maybe that's something I just need to get over. But for some reason, I have like some level of embarrassment around it.
It's like a very also you and me
seeing somebody that I think the thing I feel weirder about is the deleting message thing. Like, I feel like if someone sees like, Donna sent me a message and then deleted it, like that feels embarrassing.
I agree with that. But mark my words, there will come a day where you will thank your lucky stars that you have that. Like, every True. Once in a while, you just text the wrong person the wrong thing in a way that's more embarrassing than usual.
Yeah, that's true. You could do some like damage control that might be useful at some point. But here's a fun fact. Did you know that when you delete messages in iOS 16, it goes into like a recently deleted bin in the Messages app now, similar to the way that you have that in the Photos app?
Yeah. I learned this recently, yes.
So I think that's kind of interesting. Like, you could probably have fun going at other people's phone and going into their recently deleted folder and messages. Like, what have people been sending that they regret?
But there's a deleting message and an unsending message. And I think those are different functionalities.
Oh, it must be the unsending is what I'm talking about.
Yeah, that goes into recently deleted? I don't think so.
I thought so.
We'll have to look into that. Because yeah. I think, like, you can go and delete messages from people. Like, if somebody texts you, you can delete it off of your phone, and now it'll go into recently deleted. I think if you unsend, you just unsend. But we'll check. We'll look into that for you.
Yeah, I may have misunderstood that.
Here's the other reason, though, that I'm finding I like the editing of texts. There's a certain type of text that I send that I won't correct. So, for example, if I send the wrong emoji, I rarely will text them to be like, oops, wrong emoji. Here's the emoji I meant to send.
Yeah.
It was a different type of smiley face.
That's
But sometimes
true.
It kind of matters. Like, I accidentally sent a smirk the other day when I was trying to send a smile.
Yeah.
And there's the other day I sent a period instead of a question mark, but it like changed the context of the thing. I wouldn't usually text them to be like, I meant a question mark there, but I will go edit it.
Yeah.
I guess I feel pretty shameless about them seeing that I edited it.
I think that's something maybe I just need to get over.
You might need to get over it.
Yeah. I think the deleting, the like unsending feels weirder.
Unsending is a dramatic move. If somebody unsends a message, you know something went wrong and it really piques your interest.
Yeah.
You're like, why did they feel the need to unsend?
That exactly. One thing that I've been having issues with the beta 2 is I was kind of excited about being able to link a focus mode to a lock screen.
Yeah.
So for instance, I set up a lock screen for work that's like scissors and staplers. Like, it's like a emojis that you can also make a pattern out of on your home screen. That's another one of the new options.
Oh, I haven't tried
And then
that.
I linked that to my work focus mode so that I could just visually see I'm at work. That mode is turned on. And then I thought that if I switched my lock screen to something else, back to like my Edson and Nene, niece and nephew one, that it would, you know, automatically turn that focus mode off. But so far for me, what's happened is that when I go to my work focus mode, it turns on my work focus mode. But then when I switch to something else, it doesn't turn it off. So then
weird.
I'm still in that do not disturb focus mode when I leave work and I'm still not getting my notifications.
Oh, that's really annoying.
So I hope Apple cleans that up, because ideally it would just be a really fast and easy way to switch in and out of focus modes without having to think about it and like having that visual indicator through the lock screen. Because that, to me, that was what was useful about it.
Yeah. Totally.
So yeah, it's definitely, there's still some bugs. I still have yet to test out things like tracking medication with iOS 16, but one of our writers, I just like edited her article on that and went through to see that it works, but I haven't, you know, had hands-on experience with that, but I feel like that could be really game-changing for people.
Yeah. No, I was excited about that feature.
Yeah. And some of the mail features too, I want to start scheduling emails. That's like a feature that
you can
do.
That's one of those that is very commonly requested, so I think a lot of people do it. That's not true. For work, I could see myself doing it. Like sometimes I will.
Like on the weekend.
Yeah, on the weekend, or honestly, sometimes I'll like send an email at like midnight and I wish I could just schedule for the morning because I don't see that I was working that late.
Yeah. I mean, I rarely look at like the time of day someone's emailing me, but if it does look less professional, being like, oh, Donna emailed
me.
Midnight
on a Saturday. Yeah. I'm like, yeah.
Like, get too much of an insight into your personal life.
Yeah. Can I share a few things that I've tested this
week?
Yes. Okay. So a couple good, a couple bad. I discovered there's a new user interface for sending audio messages. Have you seen this yet?
Yes, I had the hardest time figuring it out at first. I was like pressing all the old buttons, trying to be like, I was trying to send an audio message, but I finally figured it out. It's like looks like a messages app store icon now.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
So just to put a little bit of a plug for our upcoming guide, because this is where. If you're an insider, you're going to really enjoy it. And if you're not, you really need to subscribe because there's so many little changes that you don't even hear about until you get a new operating system. And not only do you want to master them, but also sometimes one of your favorite features will get moved and you won't even know where it is or how to do it. And this is a good example, audio messages.
And there is a lot of stuff like this, you know, you need us. But really, seriously, all the lock screen features I spent a long time fiddling around with. And then I started reading the iOS 16 guide, which I'm editing right now. And I'm like, oh, that's how that works. That's how this works.
Yeah, we really spend hundreds of hours poring over these operating systems.
And this isn't just a sales pitch. A lot of you are insiders listening. So I'm just getting you hyped up for our iOS 16 guide coming out for all of you.
We're just hyping y'all up. They moved it, which was annoying because you had to find it. But they fixed it. Which is why I'm excited.
Okay, so what's better about it?
Because if you remember my complaints and learnings from like a while ago, the way it used to work was terrible because you had to hold it down to record an audio message.
Uh-huh.
And if your finger accidentally slipped, it would stop recording. But it was weirdly easy to do.
And then so, it would just send it, right?
Yeah. You'd be like recording a message and then you wouldn't notice it, but your finger would slip off. And so you'd be talking for 3 minutes. We'd only have recorded 1 minute.
Yeah.
And then the worst was if your phone, because for audio messages, sometimes, often I will send an audio message when I have more to say than I want to text. So they're often kind of long.
Yeah.
And sometimes your phone will go to sleep. If you have, especially if you're low battery mode or something like that, your phone will go to sleep after 1 minute and then it'll stop recording and you'll lose your message altogether.
So that's happened to me so many times.
So many times. So now you tap it to record the message and then you tap it when you're done. So you can't mess it up.
Yeah.
As far as I can tell, it's a lot better.
It does seem a lot better. Also, I feel like it was more confusing before. You're like, which one is going to dictate a message, but it's like translating into text, and which one is the one that's going to send an actual audio message? And the way it was laid out before also was like a bit confusing.
Yeah.
I mean, now having anything's location changed is going to confuse you again for a little bit, but it's actually a little more intuitive to have it be like, oh, this is like the audio message app looks like in messages. Oh, and then like any other microphone icon by the keyboard is what you're going to use for like dictation. It's a little more like how it seems like it should be.
Yeah, I agree. It's a little bit, once you figure it out, it's actually a little more intuitive, I think.
Yeah. Just adding in though, with audio messages, like I like to give people ideas of like why you would want to use one feature versus another. Audio messages, it took me a long time to use until my sister, who has kids, was saying how she started sending me audio messages all the time because she can't text because she's with the kids. And so it's a lot easier for her to just do that. And I think for anyone parenting or grandparenting, audio messages are a good solution.
That is. For me, when I use them, it's like when somebody texts me like, how are you doing? And I'm like, I don't know how to text you back on that. And if I do, I'll spend like 20 minutes writing a brief paragraph, or yeah. I can just send an audio message, talk for 1 minute. It won't be as like concise, novel form, but I can actually tell you how I'm doing. It's for like, to me, it's for kind of the middle ground of I don't want to have a phone call. I don't,
yeah.
But I also, it's more to convey than I have text for. And I find myself using it a lot, actually.
Yeah. It's nice, like for an asynchronous conversation with someone.
Yeah.
Because it is hard a lot of times, we're all busy, to like find a time where you can both get on the phone, but you're still able to like have more of an exchange.
Totally. So that was the good. I have a few here to go over with you.
Sweet.
The less good, they talked about when you're doing dictation mode that now emojis work, and I have not been able to get them to work. Have you?
I haven't tried, but I've seen in our Slack channel people having a hard time with it.
Okay, good. It's not just me.
Because
to me, I have yet to see this guide, this much hyped guide, because it's not out yet and I don't get to edit it.
Yeah.
So I don't know if I'm just doing it wrong, but like it still has this problem where I'll be like, the other day, I end up dictating a lot while I'm driving. And so I'll be like, grimace emoji. And then it just types the word grimace emoji and sends that. And it's so dumb.
I'm trying to check in our guide for it. I'm not seeing it right off the top of my head. So we're going to have to get back to you.
Yeah, we'll report back.
That. Yeah.
That was the bad, is it seems not be working. Maybe I'm doing it wrong. So we'll check.
Just imagine you being like, hey, Siri, I don't even know what, like, blue heart? I don't know.
Yeah, I know. It's so dumb. It literally texted somebody the words grimace emoji. And I'm just...
to do my job. If there's anything else, let me know.
Sorry, Siri.
Poor Siri is just like listening to us be like, I am insulted.
I know.
I do my best.
I'm just trying to do my job. That's funny. Anyway, carry on.
Okay. I went on a trip, so I got to test maps.
Oh.
Have you tested out maps yet?
So I loaded it up on the way to Decorah, but I didn't end up having any stops along the way, but I got to see the interface, which seemed great.
Yeah, so one nice thing is it's not just that they added stops, they redid the whole interface.
And one thing I have noticed, like the swiping screens that like let you see each stage of your trip, have you seen that?
I don't know yet.
Okay. But yes, I like the new maps experience. It's way better.
Yeah. In general, I found the whole maps interface to be a lot more intuitive than it was.
Yeah.
Adding stops was super intuitive and easy. That's the good. You ready for the bad though?
Yeah.
I'm sure they will fix this before it actually comes out. If you add a stop, currently there is no way to delete that stop.
Are you serious?
It's like once it's added, you're just going there no matter what.
That's ridiculous. I'm
sure they'll fix it. The other thing, though, that I'm actually skeptical that they will fix, because Google's been doing this for so many years, they're really good at it in a way that Apple just was not, where one of the uses I'll do for adding stops is I'll look for, especially if I'm on a road trip, like either a gas station or a restaurant along my route.
Mm.
And Google does a really good job of that. If you're like, where's a gas station? I'm driving from here to Chicago. It'll be like, here's one that's right off the highway coming up in 100 miles.
Apple's
is just
good.
Terrible at that.
Yeah.
In general, they, as expected, just were not good at it. They're like, we have one gas station and it's like 100 miles in the wrong direction. And they're like, it's useless. So I don't know if I will. I use Apple Maps except for if I'm adding stops. And I still might do that. I don't know. We'll see.
Well, part of what's been the issue for me of planning a stop along the way in the past with Apple Maps is that it gives you only a couple like preset options, like you're stopping for gas or coffee, and like that's it. And I'm like, but what? Like, it wouldn't let you add in a specific location, like type in, I want to go to Trader Joe's way.
Yeah.
Whereas with Google Maps will let you. Will this do that when you're like adding stops? It'll let you search for specific destinations?
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's like a fully functional adding stops now.
Okay, because to me that actually solves a lot of my problem.
No, it does.
A lot of times like us planning a stop along the way, I know exactly where I want to go. And it wouldn't, with Apple Maps before, it wouldn't let me choose somewhere specific.
Yeah, no. I think for most use cases, it'll solve the problem. If you like Apple Maps, you'll love this feature.
But like specifically if you're like, which gas station is going to be the least detour along my way, Google Maps still does a better job of that.
Well, one of the things I'm realizing, though, is if I'm adding stops, it's usually because I'm doing somewhat of a complicated trip.
Yeah.
And so it's like if I'm just going to two places, it's not even, I don't know, maybe this is just me, but it's not actually that beneficial. I'll usually just put in the first place, drive to the first place, and then put in the second place.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm adding stops because I'm trying to figure out like either like a stop along the best stop along the way or which route I want to take or like which Trader Joe's would be better. I'm usually doing something weird if I'm adding stops, but I find myself, I'm a planner on trips, so I find myself doing this a lot, and I don't know that it's like they added the functionality, but I don't know that Apple has enough search background to be able to allow you to do the robust types of things that I'm trying to do. But yeah, it might just be a me thing. I don't know.
No, I think you're right. Google Maps gives you more like detailed control.
Yeah.
You know, so. But it is better. And like the interface, that thing that I really liked is when I was routing, it would show me, like I could see like the overview of my route, and it would give you screens you can swipe between that would show you your next stop, and then a little white arrow would appear on the map exactly at the road that you're looking at. Sorry, it's so hard to describe these things, but in general, it let me see a lot better sort of like stops along the route visually in the kind of overview of the map view. Wow. Okay. Well, I just am going to say that the Maps interface is nicer.
I'm going to answer that with a totally. I have one more bug.
Okay.
And then I'm out for like all my hands-on for this week.
Okay.
But this bug was a particularly annoying one. Tell me if you've had this happen. The bug is it will tell you that somebody is texting you when they're not.
Oh.
So like I'll like be texting with somebody and then I'll see a little bubble like they're texting me.
Uh-huh.
And you know when you see that bubble, you're waiting.
Yeah.
But like it'll just keep going for hours.
Are you kidding me?
So you'll like check back in and they're still texting you. You're like, oh my God, they're really going to text me something serious or big.
And then it never
and
comes.
And then it never comes because they weren't texting you at all.
Oh my gosh, that's so weird. Yeah. That hasn't happened to me.
I asked some of the editors and they've had it too. So it's not just me.
That's bizarre. Yeah.
I don't know. I think hopefully they'll clean it up, but it's one of those bugs that
could create some like real misunderstandings between people. Apple, better fix that.
Well, especially, I mean, what's happened to me a couple times is I will be having a somewhat serious conversation with somebody and then those bubbles will come up and then I'll sit there and then I'll wait and then I'll wait. And you really, it causes anxiety.
Yeah. That's, hopefully that's fix really it. Bad. It's like Apple's April Fool's joke
yeah.
on all of us.
How about you? Any other hands-on things you want to share?
That's all I've got right now. I did want to – I forgot. I skipped over our news update section, and I did want to tell all of you that iPadOS 16, it looks like, won't release until October. Usually the iOS and iPadOS releases come out at the same time in September. But it's interesting now with certain Apple rumors, it's like basically reported as fact now. And a lot of times it's right. Like Bloomberg reported like iPadOS 16 is coming out in October. Apple has not said that, but it seems to be the consensus that that's what's happening. And
yeah.
I would be surprised if that's not what's happening.
And especially you can often tell based on who's leaking it.
Like yeah,
there's
Bloomberg's
a few
good.
Sources that Apple will deliberately tell, and it'll be almost like an unofficial press release. And this one, too, makes sense because I'm guessing they will have an iPhone event in September and then an iPad event in October. So releasing
yeah.
iPadOS 16 with the new iPads makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, that's sort of the latest. Like September, we'll get the iPhone and Apple Watch.
Yeah.
And in October, the iPad and maybe a Mac release, too.
Yeah.
So... yeah, not that we plan talking about it in this episode, but do you know what you want to, like, what are you hoping to see this fall and what you want to buy?
Oh, man. No. I mean, I'm really curious to see the new iPads, the iPad Pros, because I think they'll have an M2 chip and
yeah.
Be pretty powerful devices. I'm excited about the new iPhones, but I haven't heard any, like, crazy new features. Oh, I will say this. I'm really interested to learn about the VR. Because it's been a while since we've had a new Apple category, and I'm real curious to see what they did on that.
And you think we will get it?
Or? I don't know that we'll get it. I think we'll get it later this year,
uh-huh.
or they might even announce it and have it not come out till next year.
Hmm.
But yeah, it's coming. It's coming.
It's exciting.
Yeah. How about you?
I really want to get a new iPad. Okay. I've decided, so I have, I've so far only invested in a lower end iPad, and then I'm talking about that I never use it. And I'm realizing that that is why. It's really slow. It's like really slow. And the display is not that nice. But I now am setting up a smart home, which I'm so excited about for our annual buyer's guide, which is also a reason to be an insider and, you know, get the digital subscription to the magazine. But I want to have an iPad like set up in the living room and kitchen that I can just use for all smart home related things.
I like that.
And right now I've been using my iPad just to kind of get started with that, because I also want, like, once it's kind of the home iPad, I want to use it also in the kitchen for recipes and to like control music and podcasts. Mm. So I've been doing that. But like the load time is crazy slow. Some of it is I did put the iPadOS 16 beta on it, which might be part of the problem. But just in general, like I feel like I would use it a lot more if it just was like a more powerful device with a really nice display.
Yeah, I agree. I'm a big proponent of the like pros. Like, because other ones are totally fine, so it's so tempting to get them. But really, the iPad is kind of a luxury device anyway. Like, you're kind of getting it out of convenience. So getting a budget version of something for convenience, it ends up having these weird trade-offs.
So do you think I should get, like, I mean, right now I'm looking at the Mini and the iPad Air. They're both really nice. But I'm like, maybe I should wait till October and see what the Pro looks like.
I think anybody looking for iPads right now should wait until October, to be honest. The other thing I'm really excited about, actually, now that we're bringing up smart homes, they're coming out. I read they're coming out with a bunch of new smart home / HomePod related products.
Mm.
And I love my HomePods. I have a HomePod Mini and a HomePod Large, and I think it's a not appreciated enough device because everybody talks about Alexa being so much farther along, and it is in a lot of ways. But the HomePod has a lot of advantages over Alexa, and I love mine. So if I'm really glad to hear.
What's a HomePod again? I'm kidding. Oh. I feel like so many people don't know.
Yeah, a lot of,
but yeah, if you don't know and you're listening, don't feel bad about it. You're not alone.
It's Apple's smart speaker.
Yeah.
They used to have a large one, which had great sound quality, and I loved it. They got rid of it, which I'm sad. Now they have HomePod Mini, which are really convenient and affordable. But it lets you use Siri. So if you have a smart home, it's amazing. And just in general, I find it to be very convenient. So they're coming out with new ones, which I'm excited about. And I think they might have some smart home products, which I'm really interested in.
I wonder, what they'll be.
I don't know. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to be, over the next few weeks, having a lot of smart home products that I'll be talking about in our apps and gear section. Right now, they're just starting to roll in, though, so I have an app today to talk about. Okay. If we're done talking about the data, I am. And you have some gear here.
I have a smart home product, actually.
Okay, let's hear it.
Okay, so my smart home product is by a company called Nanoleaf, and Nanoleaf has smart lights, but I would call them, I don't know if this is a correct term for it, but like decorative lighting. So there's these panels that you put on your wall, and they're modular. So the one I got this time, I had one years ago and I just got new ones. They're called Nanoleaf Elements. And what's cool about them is that they are, the panel has a wood veneer on the front. So it looks like kind of a wood panel. It comes in a hexagon shape, and it comes with six of them, I believe, maybe eight, one or the other. And so you arrange them on your wall in whatever shape you want, and then you can control the lights on them. And you can either just have like a nice warm, soft glow in your room, or you can have it's responsive to touch and to music. So you can actually have it like flicker based on music. I just found it to be really fun. It's not the most practical of item, but it's fun. And if you have a home where it would look appropriate, I think it's a really cool addition. In particular, the thing in the past, what I had, there were these like triangular modules that looked cool, but looked super techy, and they flashed bright colors, which was fun. But in general, it wasn't, if you had a home where you'd invest in a lot of nice furniture, it could look a little bit dorky depending on your style. This, I feel like, fits pretty well into a nice like home with nice furniture, but also is a fun tech addition to a home. So I've been enjoying playing with it. I have one in my home. I had a lot of fun setting it. Also, I will say, I have rarely seen a smart home product that was this well designed in terms of ease of setup, because it's a complicated thing. You have a bunch of hexagons, and you have to like connect them with a connector and then set them up in an app.
Yeah, it sounds like a pain.
Yeah, and it was not. I mean, it is a pain, but it's really well thought through and designed, and it was really easy to do, even though it took me a while. The thing that took me a while is you get a little bit like, at least I got a little bit obsessed over like what shape I want it to look like.
Yeah,
and I
spent like a long kind of time. Fun.
Yeah, but I thought it was particularly well thought out product in terms of ease of use.
Nice. And yeah, Nanoleaf is awesome. They're actually sending me their new like essentials pack. Like they have light strips. Maybe you've tried their light strips.
I have not. I've tried Hue's light strips, which I like.
Okay. So Hue might send me some too, but I'm trying Nanoleaf's light strips, and now they have also light bulbs that do like different cool lighting.
Oh, cool.
Tricks.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I'm going to try those because a lot of people in the office have tried the Nanoleaf, the wall panels like that you're talking about, which sound really cool, but I was like, probably I should review something different since you guys have all talked about that
That's
already.
Fair. Yeah. And they have ones now. They have a bunch of line of products that are good. I will say as far as light bulbs go, I haven't tested these, so they might be excellent, but I am really a firm believer in Philips Hue's.
I'm getting both to do side-by-side
cool.
testing. Yeah.
You'll have to report back because I've never tested Nanoleaf. They seem to have very well thought out products.
Yeah.
Philips Hue's is just like, I've never had an issue. They just always work. And they're easy to set up. And I have them all over my house now. And I've splurged a little and I have colored light bulbs all over. You've seen.
Yeah.
And so you can set up a scene for your whole home where you have like a whole... Everybody always makes fun of me that it looks like my house is always having a party. But it's fun.
Yeah. I mean, lighting is so important for creating a vibe.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And like setting... like. Fluorescent lighting, early cold lighting can make a really great homey space feel horrible. So I think it's really important.
Totally.
I'm excited to work with smart lights more.
I'm excited to hear all your smart home reviews.
Thanks.
Yeah, what do you have? Tell us about your app.
So Planta is the app. It's kind of on the smart home theme because I now have so many plants. Sarah Kingsbury, who you know used to be one of the co-hosts on this podcast, she's our... editorial director. She is amazing with plants and she just moved and has given rehomed many of her plants with me.
Aww.
Including I bought this Monstera from her. It's this massive, amazing plant. But anyway, I really don't want to kill these plants. And so I now have downloaded this app, Planta, to help me. Because before I would just water my plants like once a week if I remember and like hope for the best. But yeah, so this lets you go room by room and like register all of your plants into the app, set up like what's the lighting situation. It has a bunch of different lighting options, like is it in shade, partial shade, what like level of light, all for free features. They have like premium ones too, features, but like also plant identification. Like I have some weird looking succulents that I'm like, I have no idea what this is. Mm-hmm. You can take a picture. It'll tell you what it is.
Cool.
And I will give you a schedule and send you notifications of when you're supposed to water it. It also has like detailed watering instructions. Like I kind of thought you just water your plant and that's a day, call it a day, but it'll ask you questions about like, what's your drainage like on the plant? It'll tell you how to give your plant a bath, which is like a different thing.
Oh my gosh.
And, so it's just breaking it down a lot more. And like also sometimes like the edges of my leaves will be brown or like one leaf will turn yellow. I don't know if that means I've underwatered it or overwatered
it.
Yeah,
me neither.
And so I'm really hoping I'll have to report back. Like I've now registered the plants and I have the schedule set up and it's really satisfying to go in and like check off when I've watered the plants. But I'm curious how it's going to help me with nursing certain plants back to health and diagnose whether it's like rotting because I've overwatered it or if it's like super thirsty. Wish me luck.
I'm glad to hear you're on that level too.
I'm like, what does this mean?
You're like, I either overwatered it or underwatered it and I have no way of knowing. And then like people who are really into plants are like, oh yeah, of course, you just do this and this. I'm like, I have no idea.
Yeah. And Sarah's one of those people with cooking and with plants. She'll just be like, it's easy. And we're like, no,
well,
not for us.
And I love Sarah, but she also gave me a couple plants and she, before she left, would come and inspect them to tell me how I was doing,
and
which was
you...
very stressful. No, I'm totally killing them. I'm doing my best.
Yeah.
I'll check out this app.
Yeah, this one, Plant. There's a few apps out there like this, so
yeah.
Planta's not your only option, but Planta has like one of the App Store Editor's Choice Awards, it seems to be. a pretty well-known one that's supposed to be good. But yeah, it's interesting. You can subscribe for Dr. Planta. It's kind of like the insider for plants because you get like access to the Planta team. If you're having like specific problems, you can talk to the plant doctor, Planta doctor. I'm hoping to not
have problems.
Need that. But so far, all my plants are alive. But if the Monstera gets sick, I'm going to upgrade for Dr. Planta.
The Monstera is beautiful.
Yeah. It's a treasure.
I've had good luck with them, actually.
Really?
They're pretty hardy, yeah.
Oh, good.
And I work hard to kill plants. So. Cool. Right. I think we did it.
Yes, we did. Thank you so much for tuning in. We'll be back in a couple weeks with more iOS 16 public beta experiences. It's going to be leading up to the announcement, too. So as the rumors are solidifying for the September release, we're going to have a lot to talk about there. And what else? Any other housekeeping?
Well, if you're an insider, stick around. We got some bonus content for y'all.
Yes, stick around. Thanks.
Thanks, everyone.